días a todos, gracias por venir. Hoy tenemos la suerte de contar aquí en el CIO, gracias a la Cátedra Santander de Eficiencia y Productividad, por la presencia de Magdalena Capelco, de la Universidad de Breslavia, en Polonia. Y viene a hablarnos sobre una aplicación del análisis dinámico para estudiar la eficiencia en empresas cárnicas en Europa. Y nada, pues muchísimas gracias, Magdalena, por venir. Va a ser el inglés de la charla, que es el tema más común con Cabrera. Luego las preguntas sí pueden ser en castellano, si queréis, porque me entiendes perfectamente. Así que muchas gracias.
Gracias. Bueno, en primer lugar, yo quiero agradecer al Centro de Investigación Cooperativa y a la Cátedra Santander en Eficiencia y Productividad por invitarnos y invitarnos aquí a Elche. Bueno, muchas gracias por el ambiente tan científico que he vivido estos días, bueno, ya semanas, y por tratarme con tanta amistad. Y ahora sí que voy a cambiar de idioma un poquito. Well, so the paper I will present today is a paper, joint paper with Alfons van der Wansink from Wageningen University in the Netherlands. As Juan already told, well, the paper is about the measurement of managerial and program efficiency in the context of a specific approach that I will explain later, which is a dynamic multidirectional efficiency analysis approach, and the application is in the European meat manufacturing industry. My presentation is divided into five parts, which follow the structure of the paper. So I will begin with introduction, so a little bit of motivation and objective of the study, and I will also present you a little bit of background information about the meat manufacturing industry. Then I will develop the methods in detail, and then I will explain the empirical applications. So I will provide you some information about data sets, and I will brief you further and explain the results, and of course I will end up with some comments. So moving to the first part of my presentation, to the introduction. So, with this paper, we aim to contribute to the literature on the measurement of efficiency for a group of firms that are characterized by different technologies. So, this literature began with the paper of Charnes et al. From 1981, and they proposed an approach within data and development analysis framework to distinguish between managerial and program efficiency. So managerial, the idea is that managerial efficiency is assessed in relation to the group-specific frontier, so it's a different group of firms, and we assess efficiency separately from each group, and we measure efficiency in relation to this specific group-specific frontier, and program efficiency. Program efficiency measures the distance between group-specific frontier and food frontier. Food frontier, that is frontier composed of all observations. So this is the seminal paper of this literature, of this field of research. Then in 2004, Battesta et al., they followed this line of research. They advanced the idea of Charnes et al. So in the seminal paper. And in this paper from 2004, they introduced the concept of meta-frontier, which the basic idea is exactly the food protein, the protein that spans all of convention. They also talk about group-specific frontier. They also introduce the something that they call technology gaps, which in fact is exactly program efficiency. But surprisingly, this paper never cites Charnes et al. So they do very similar things, but they never cite Charnes et al. Okay, so this is Battesta. They do it in the context of stochastic frontier, and then in 2008, O'Donnell, they proposed a similar framework of meta frontier, but in the context of data development analysis. So this is like the foundation, theoretical foundation for this line of research. And of course, there are lots of empirical applications of the concept of meta frontier, program efficiency, and managerial efficiency. Okay, so this is the first line of research. Then with this study, we aim to contribute to this second line of research, which is the measurement of dynamic efficiency in the DA framework. The basic idea of dynamic efficiency is that we want to account for the fact that firms' production resilience are being compromised. It's true, not just that it's impossible to think about some decisions, production decisions, that they will not, that we undertake in one period, that they will not impact future. So the idea is to account for this. And this literature is also quite rich already, there are many studies. And basically, these studies could be classified into two groups. So we have networks models, networks, network dynamic VR, which the idea is multi-stage production systems. And there is a second group of studies that are based on the theory of adjustment costs. So that the link between firms' production decisions over time are associated with adjustment costs. That comes from changes in capital stock from investment. Later on, I will explain it in detail. And in this study, we focus on this second line of research, this adjustment cost theory. Okay, so so these two lines of research, then we mix them, and we want to combine the concept of the managerial program efficiency with dynamic efficiency measurement. In particular, in this paper, we built on our different study that we have with Alphons from 2016, where we developed this dynamic multi-directional inefficiency approach. Later on, I will explain it in more detail. So, in this paper that I'm presenting now, we use this approach that we developed earlier, and we applied to develop the measures of managerial and program efficiency. And the model we developed, it allows to analyze efficiency with regard to specific inputs and events. Okay, so this is from the motivation and objectives point of view, and now a little bit of background information about meat manufacturing industry in Europe. So meat manufacturing industry, this is the largest sector within food manufacturing industry, and as we all know, food manufacturing in Europe is one of the most important sectors for the government of different countries. These are some interesting trends, the things that are going on in this sector in the last decade. In this paper, we analyzed the figure 2005 and 2012, so this is more or less what was happening in this industry during this period. So in general, this industry is very highly regulated by the European Union. There are lots of regulations. Just one of the most famous regulations from 2002, the general food law, with all these regulations that we remember, there were also food crises, lots of scandals with food. So after all this, the European Union needed to introduce stronger regulations regarding the food safety. So the regulations are impacting this industry. Also, the trade in products is liberalizing. And of course, also one impacting factor was the 2008 financial crisis that in this year of the meat manufacturing first in Europe decreased the turnover. So this is the background. So now I can move to the second part of my presentation, and I will try to develop and explain them. Okay, so as I already told, the method we use this dynamic multi-directional inefficiency approach, and we use it to develop the measures of program and managerial inefficiency. So, what is this dynamic managerial? It is dynamic multi-directional inefficiency approach. So this approach is it's a combination between static multi-directional inefficiency approach and dynamic efficiency. So, I will explain a little bit about what is the static multidirectional efficiency approach and what is the dynamic approach. And then I will show what is happening when we mix both of them. Okay, so the idea of multidirectional efficiency approach is to separate the benchmark selection from a measurement of efficiency. So in this approach, the benchmarks are not selected according to actual production as it is in the normal DNA, but are selected according to their potential improvements, according to ideal goals, which I will explain later. So this is the basic idea. So we separate these two issues. So automatically the method is undertaken in two steps. So in the first step, we need to calculate this ideal point. We need to solve, I will solve later on the linear program for each input separately. And then we have a single program, and the outcome of this program is used to calculate the inefficiency rate. So the static approach, it comes from Bogatov and Hogarth, and then it was advanced by Asimov et al. So this is this approach. And then dynamic approach, I already mentioned, know that we use this approach, which is based on the theory of adjustment cost. So basically, what this adjustment cost hypothesis says is, which is logical, I think, because, well, when we make some investment in the company, when we buy some equipment, of course, we will need to pay some cost of learning to use this equipment, or first of all, of looking for this equipment. There will be some costs that we incur when we make investments. And these are all adjustments. So in this approach, we account for this adjustment cost, well, but implicitly, it's accounted by the higher usage of variable input. From this approach, we distinguish between variable and quasi-fixed inputs for inefficiency measurements. And general idea of all the models is that we want to use variable inputs and expand inputs. So basically, investments is our dynamic factor. So we want to reduce variable inputs and at the same time expand investments. So these are two approaches. So they were going on like separately. So for mixing these two approaches, what we get, we get these different models. We can try to explain it briefly. So in all these models, we assume n variable inputs, f growth investment, f quantitative input, and output. We also need the depreciation rate, which is another delta. And as I already told, we have two steps. So in the first step, we need to compute this ideal reference point. So we need to solve this problem separately for each variable input. What is perhaps peculiar about this program is, well, we have vector of all variable inputs except input n. Well, the rest more or less is standard, not the value of n input reduction, and then we have the constants for output, well, and the constants for investments, which is connected with the dynamic framework. This is the investment that we use. So we need to solve it for each variable input to get the ideal reference point for the variable input. Then we do similar program for investments. We need to translate ideal points. Well, we need to solve this model separately for each investment. So similar ideas, we use the vector of all investments except investment F, which is the value for investment expansion. We want it to reduce variable input, but we want it to expand growth investment. Well, and the constant for output and for variable input. Okay, so then solving the separate programs, we have the values of this ideal reference point for each variable input for each investment. And then using these values, we go to the second step and we solve this single program. We have this program we have beta, which is the measure of technical inefficiency. So this is the proportion by which variable inputs are reduced and investments are expanded, and relatively to this ideal reference point. So this is specific about this approach. So we have differences. So we have this input-specific axis, which is the difference between the actual value of variable input and this ideal value, and we have investment specific sources, so this is the difference between ideal value of investments and actual value of investments. So this is, here we can see mainly the difference between the normal VA. In the normal VA, we will have this adjustment in proportion to actual production. And here we have the adjustment in proportion to this, this potential, improvement potential, this difference. And the difference, on the other hand, the difference between static multidirectional efficiency approach would be that in the static approach, we will only have this variable input. We will not have this. So basically, this is just the summary of the difference. Okay, so we have the data, and then we can calculate already the inefficiency scores. As I already told, the input specific inefficiency scores for each variable input and for each investment. Well, in the physical application, I will have only one type of investment, only two variables. So the, we want to reduce variable input, so the values of inefficiency scores for variable input will be between 0 and 1, the way we define it, where 0 means 100% of efficiency, so these are inefficiency measures, no? And the part are investments, we want to expand them, so the value of investment will be larger than 0. With 0, we mean that it is, again, that is 100% of efficiency. And more means inefficiency. So this is the basic model. And now we go on a little bit further because we want to develop this model for measuring inefficiency for group of persons. So, so we want to calculate managerial efficiency and program efficiency. So going on to managerial efficiency. So efficiency assessed with regard to group-specific control. So this is very easy task because what we do, we just split the sample and we undertake all these previous steps, two steps, but separately for each sub-sample. We compute inefficiency with regard to this group-specific frontier. So we have, again, this ideal reference point, we have this optimal solution that we use to compute inefficiency of investments and of variable input. So this is a very easy task. Then program inefficiency. It's also not very complicated task, but comparing to managerial inefficiency is a little bit more complicated, but because what we do with program inefficiency, first we need to compute frontier values. So we compute the values of variable input and investment that are managerially efficient relatively to group specific frontiers. So these are basically the formulas that allow us to compute it for variable input and for investments. So we have like a new set of like a new sample of with different values of variable input and investment. These are managerially efficient. And we use this value and we run again these two steps, step one and step two, but this time relatively to the pool frontier. So to the frontier spans with all observations. And in this way, we can compute programming efficiency. That is the difference between pool frontier and group frontier, no? As I already told. So again, we will have the values of ideal points and we'll have this optimal solution that we are able to compute the values of input specific and investment specific inefficiency. This time, this is a program. Okay, so these are the models, and now maybe the easiest way to see with this feature. So, what we have in this graph? We assume two groups of terms, G1 and G2. Well, on the X axis, we have investments, I, and on the Y axis, we have variable input. We have two groups. In this graph, we assume that group 2, G2 is the same as pooled frontier, which is denoted with capital F, with capital G. And in this graph, we assume that this observation is X0, I0 belongs to the group G1. And to compute managerial inefficiency, so the inefficiency for group G1 with regards to G1.0. So we find this ideal reference point, and we project on the front view, following again the path to decrease into and expand that expand investment in the direction of this ideal point. So we have this formal projection. The difference between XBIB and 0.0 is the measure of managerial inefficiency. And then to compute program inefficiency, we need to calculate this managerial inefficiency value. So first we need to make this calculation. After making these calculations, we, with this new value, we find again a new ideal form, and we project in the direction of this ideal point, well, and we project this time on the full frontier, no? Because we estimated the full frontier. So we get the point XDT, IDT, and the distance between XDT, IDT, and XDIB is the measure of programming. So this is the idea, no? The basic idea, intuitive idea of this approach. So this is the theoretical part. And now I move to the empirical application, how to apply all this. So to apply this model, we use the data, accounting data that comes from Amadeus database. We focus only on large meat manufacturing fields in Europe. The period from 2005 to 2012 is unbalanced panel. And we distinguish three groups of fields. Our groups to estimate managerial efficiency. We divided the sample into Western Europe, Eastern Europe, and Southern Europe. Well, but basically the sample is based mainly on the data availability, but also within different regions, we have countries which are the main meat producers in different regions in Europe. And these are only large meat manufacturing firms. The specific variable we use and we need to estimate our model. So we have one output, which are revenues. We have two variable inputs, material cost and labor cost. So all accounting data coming from directly from Amadeus. We have one quasi-fixed input, which are fixed assets. We need to compute gross investments in fixed assets. To compute gross investments, we need the values of fixed assets in 2 years, and we need the value of depreciation. And we also, as we have seen in the models, for gross investments, they also appear in the models, we need the values of depreciation. So everything comes from Amadeus, and we, based also on Amadeus data, we compute gross investments. Well, the data taken from Amadeus was in local currencies of different countries. So to account for the differences between countries, we apply two changes to our parity of the local currency to the US dollar, and of course we deflate also that to create this implicit quantity. So we divided the value by a price index using a country specific and variable specific price index. And of course before we also looked for the presence of afterlife to control this for the afterlife. Okay. Important to control the presence of afterlife. So, using this data and applying our models, what we get is this is what we get. Okay, so first for managerial inefficiency. What we see, what we can find from managerial inefficiency? We see that these are the average values of the standardization. So, we see that basically for all input and investments, for materials, labor, and investment, the highest values are for Eastern European firms, so that this firm, this is the managerial inefficiency, the inefficiency with regard to group-specific frontiers, so you can conclude that the firms are the least homogeneous in terms of labor force compared to Western and Southern European firms. On the contrary, our Southern European firms, which has the lowest value of the inefficiency, so they are, compared to other groups, they are more homogeneous in terms of their performance. How to interpret the values? Well, these are the inefficiency values. So for example, the Eastern European fields for materials, the value is 0.0, 277, so it means that Eastern European states have the scope to reduce materials in 27%, no? Light labor 33%, and there are quite, well, very big budget for investment. So, well, the conclusion is that Eastern European states could increase investment by 90%. It might be a bit surprising, but actually this is what we always get with this approach. When applying different models, different combinations, we always get very huge values of investment. So, well, basically, probably, well, technology allows for increasing investment until that point, but probably maybe there are some other constraints we do not take into account that would not allow to increase investment until such a, this is our interpretation that we have so far. Okay, so this is about managerial inefficiency. So this is the evolution across the whole all period from 2005 to 2012. This is the evolution. It is a little bit hard to explain because they are we are still this is a working paper and we are still working on how to interpret the findings separately for each for material labor and investment. And we have, of course, our three groups, Eastern, Western, and Southern. So perhaps increasing our investment that we see like stable pattern, but for example, for Western firms, we observe some jumps in efficiency, increments of inefficiency. And this is in 2008, well, 2008, and also in 2009. So when we are trying to expand, we are trying to link it perhaps with the crisis, but maybe in 2008, well, this is what was happening. The firms were forced to cut investments. Also, they needed to cut investment in Western Europe. So, of course, there was some capacity left unused. So, finally, inefficiency for investment increased. But, of course, there are more things that we need to look more into more detail in the program. So moving to the program inefficiency, so the distance, the difference between a group specific frontier and full frontier. So here the lowest values are in Eastern Europe, so the gap between the full frontier and group specific frontier is the smallest. So they, well, although they were not performing well when, with regard to the team specific frontier, but it seems that the best practice teams from Eastern Europe, they are closer to the food frontier than others, so they have the better with regard to the food frontier. Well, the opposite situation is presented for Western Europe. What else? Well, in general, well, the investments, we have huge values of investments, but also there are huge values of standardization, so there is huge variation within the sample. And we also control for the outliers of investments. So this is not the matter of compliance, but this is really what is happening. The potential for increased investment is so good. All right, so these are the average over the period, and then again, I have to take evolution. So perhaps the increasing evolution of materials and labor for the Western and Southern firms. Also hard to have like the clear conclusions, but we can see that, for example, they increase now in 2008. So again, it might be connected with the financial crisis. Again, they have some capacity left unused because of the decreasing demand, etc. Okay, so this is, but this is also the method of program inefficiency, so we also have to be careful in interpreting this. And following the last set of results is food inefficiency, so inefficiency with regard to the frontier span of all observations. So here what we find that with regard to food frontier, the best performing food in our sample are Eastern Europe. So this is the food inefficiency, of course, is the consequence of two other inefficiencies, managerial and profit. So as we have seen before, Eastern European states have low values of the programming of the system. So this is the consequence that they have come from their own values of food. So that the most efficient and the way from the alternatives are the most inefficient means that are food, food inefficient. And of course, and again, we see this huge variation where food product, the business product is the means of investment. Perhaps still would be even better to show the median balance instead of minimum, especially for investment. So that is also for research. And again, we have some evolution. So what perhaps could keep or could be existing? Well, what we could keep, for example, Western and Southern firms. What is happening? Well, there is also like different situations, but maybe from 2000, already from 2000, let's say, 9, we see some decrease in the efficiency of labor. Maybe it could be also explained by the crisis, because, well, it's possible that the firms were becoming more efficient with regard to labor, no? They were also, well, maybe it's not nice thing to say, but reductions in employees, but it could cause that inefficiency decreases and efficiency increases. Well, but this is basically happening in Western and Southern Europe, which were one of the reasons also impacted by the crisis. So, the Eastern Europe, I have to say, majority of people were doing well in the country. Okay, so this is the reason, but of course, we need to look at this more deeply because there are some situations and to try to explain it better. Okay, so now I can move to the conclusion. So the objective of the paper was to develop an approach to measure managerial and program inefficiency using the approach of dynamic multi-directional inefficiency analysis using data development analysis. What we find is that Eastern European firms have the highest dynamic managerial inefficiency, so they are the most inefficient with regards to group-specific protein, but they are most efficient with regards to food protein. So compared to other groups, they are doing well. So within groups, they do not do so well. Western European teams perform work in terms of program inefficiency, so the gap between group-specific protein and food protein is the largest for Western European teams. And Southern European teams score lowest for dynamic managerial efficiency. So within groups, within their group, they on average they do well, subject to the best. This is what we find. And in general, the trend what we find that the most inefficient input of materials, followed by labor and health investment, were having this what, let's say, huge values of inefficiency. So this is the summary of the conclusion. And of course, there is some future research going on, because as I told you, this is a working paper, so of course we need to explain in detail all these findings, why we observe what we observe. Then another expression, the expression of the work could be, these are efficiency measures, it's possible to also to develop models for productivity change. Also, perhaps interesting issue would be because now we analyze groups, this regional group, Eastern, Western, but of course there is still heterogeneity within the group. So, of course, it would be interesting in the future to look at specific countries. So, you can see really what was happening. And, of course, for sure, bootstrapping would be needed to all of these operations. Okay, so thank you very much for your attention. Some comments, suggestions, questions, of course, or answer them.
Yes, no, pero alguna pregunta. Yo sí, bueno, te quería preguntar.
Sí.
¿Por qué habéis utilizado MED? Que habéis utilizado Direction Distance Function directamente, ¿no? Porque bueno, si el MED también es una Direction Distance Function en cierto sentido, pero con un paso previo
¿por qué no lo habéis utilizado directamente en la dirección de esta fase? ¿Hay algún motivo o queréis extender?
Bueno, el primer motivo es que ya tenemos Facebook en la dirección de esta fase. Aprovechamos bien, ¿no? Pero también creo que Samea tiene unas propiedades bastante interesantes, ¿no? Que cumple algunas propiedades que otras medidas no cumplan. Para dar una razón así más formal, es este. Pero así desde el punto de vista de la práctica, es que ya tenemos el test con interés en el compacto.
Y luego, si alguno de ustedes habéis pensado en utilizar también alguna medida, ¿no? Que cuentas de alguna forma las ineficiencias que vengan, por los slacks, la estructura.
Gracias.